We are doing a benefit for the ACLU at QED, Friday, November 18th, swipe left. The great John Fugelsang, Frank Conniff, Jeffrey Joseph, Jessica Kirson. The show starts at 7:30. All profits go to the ACLU. Tickets are $10. Let me repeat, swipe left with John Fugelsang, Frank Conniff, Jeffrey Joseph, Jessica Kirson. Tickets are $10. I'll be on the show, but you should come anyway. All the profits go to the ACLU, Friday, November 18th at QED. That's QEDAstoria.com.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, DavidFeldmanShow.com. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter. Go to the David Feldman Show website, and you'll see an Amazon banner. Click on that and do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show, and we get a small percentage of everything you buy. Greg Proops is on the show today, the smartest man in the world. And we'll also have Buckles and David Cyrus later on. We're going to do a little roundtable about what happened last week. A couple of you wrote angry letters to me complaining that the day after the election, we did an episode on cats, all about cats. Some of you thanked me, but a lot of you were incensed that that's how I dealt with the news. Well, yeah. No comment. I want to talk to you about political satire as we're waiting for Greg Proops. You got to stop listening to comedians. You got to stop getting your news from comedians. It's fun to watch The Daily Show. It's fun to watch Bill Maher. It's fun to watch Colbert. They're great. And this show is great. But it's dessert. You're only entitled to listen to this show after you ate your vegetables and your veggie burgers. This kind of show and the kind of shows where they laugh at what's going on in the world is what you watch after you've educated yourself and then after you've done something good for your community. There's some kind of self-aggrandizement that goes on in the comedy community. There's a laziness in the fans of the comedy community who thank comedians and political satirists for all the great work they do. Well, the political satirists are making money. The ones on television are all multimillionaires, and they're part of the game. And they're great at what they do, but in the end, they manufacture consent, as Noam Chomsky says. They make us all compliant. Laughing is a powerful weapon to some degree, but in the end, it's an opiate. It's a narcotic. It gives you license to feel good. It does make you feel good, and it makes you feel as though you accomplished something. Laughing is not the answer. You have to get out there and do something. You're not entitled to laugh until you've done something. That's why Donald Trump won, because the liberals, our side, we're smug and we're laughing while the white racists, secessionists, are taking out the billy clubs and beating people. You know, there are really no great conservative political satirists. Those people are not busy laughing. They're not worrying about whether or not they get the joke. They're not worried about whether or not they're smart and smug. They're busy taking out their guns and ruining our democracy, if it's even left to be ruined. It's pretty much over, and I'll talk about that. That doesn't mean you have to give up. I mean, I think it ended probably when Bush got elected. Stop talking about political satire, the importance of political satire. Jonathan Swift wrote A Modest Proposal in, I believe, the early 1700s, where he talked about eating babies. eating Irish babies. And everybody talks about that as the gold standard of political satire and how much he accomplished and how brilliant Jonathan Swift was. Well, how did that turn out for Irish babies? About 150 years later, they were being eaten because of the famine. Political satire does not move the needle. It just makes you feel good. It reinforces what you already know. And, you know, maybe I'm saying this because I'm a professional comedy writer and I'm threatened by all the young people coming up who are funny, funnier, smarter than I am, better than what I do. I know everybody wants to be a comedy writer. I know everybody wants to be a comedian. I know everybody wants to have their own improv group. I've got kids who are studying at UCB. You know, I meet so many funny lawyers who hate what they're doing. F you. I hate what I'm doing, so I'm going to take an improv class. Go stick your head in a garbage disposal, you piece of dung. You have a law degree? And you want to go do comedy? Do you realize the work that has to be done right now? Who Trump is going to appoint? This guy, Ebel, the world's most renowned climate change denier, is going to be named to be the head of the EPA by Donald Trump. Put down your effing video games. Stop taking your UCB classes on improv and get to work. Okay. We're going to talk to Greg Proops, and then we're going to call Chuck Schumer's office and tell him to step aside for Elizabeth Warren. He should not be the Senate minority leader. It should be Elizabeth Warren. Chuck Schumer is a coward. He's a tool of Wall Street. He's my senator. I voted for him. He's not up for the job. We need an obstructionist running the Democratic Party in the Senate. We need to start filibustering. We have to bring the wheels of government to a complete stop the way Ted Cruz and all the other Republicans do. You cannot give Donald Trump, McConnell, or Ryan the benefit of the doubt. You have to bring it to a halt. You cannot approve any of their judges. You cannot approve any of the people they appoint to the cabinet. You have to stop Washington, D.C. peacefully through the political process. And the way you do that is you scare the hell out of our leaders, our side. The Clintons are gone. The Clintons are gone. They're done. That's over. They taught us how to win, right? That's why we voted for Bill Clinton. He was the only Democrat who knew how to win. And we were so frightened that Obama's legacy would be ruined. We played it safe and voted for Hillary because the Clintons know how to win. And she wouldn't even wait a full day to challenge the results. She conceded within 10 hours, 8 hours. She won the popular vote. And she couldn't wait till all the votes were counted just to make sure. Just maybe, maybe, just maybe she might have won when all the absentee votes are counted. But you know what? Her people, Podesta, Rahm Emanuel, all the people, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, all the people who ran her campaign, in the end, their life is not going to change whether or not she's president. They're going to get rich either way. They don't care. And you know, they didn't even realize they were supposed to rig the entire election. They just rigged it against Bernie. They were supposed to rig the entire thing. So the Clintons are done. It's Elizabeth Warren's turn. And after we talk to Greg Proops, we are going to call Senator Schumer's office. And all of you who are listening to me, I'm going to give you his number. And you're all going to call Senator Schumer and leave a message telling him to step aside so Elizabeth Warren can be the minority leader in the Senate. And then we're going to later on call Nancy Pelosi and tell her to step aside so that Keith Ellison can be the minority leader in the House, not the head of the Democratic National Committee, the minority leader. That's why the Republican Party won and continues to win, because they have real debate on their side. They're not sclerotic. They're fighting. They're vicious. And they're winning because the free marketplace of ideas that exists inside the Republican Party, that's what makes a success. That's how people thrive when they're competing against each other. That's why the Republicans are winning. Our side, bunch of cowards. We're so afraid of getting what we really want. And we got what we want. We won the popular vote, and the Clintons quit. They didn't even give it a day. Do you think had the shoe been on the other tiny foot, you think Trump would have conceded as early? No. We'll be right back with Greg Proops. Joining us from Los Angeles is the smartest man in the world, Greg Proops. Hello, Mr. Proops.
Hello, Mr. Feldman. How are you, Rabbi?
The only way I'm going to shut up, by the way, because I need to talk to you.
Mm-hmm.
The only way I can deal with this kind of stuff is by getting angry.
Yes.
The alternative is depression. So I'm angry, and thank God I get to talk to Ralph Nader once a week. I do a radio show with Ralph Nader, and he gives me marching orders. And my orders are to call and write members of my party and tell them what to do and work within the system. So I'm channeling all my rage at the Democratic Party, but I don't want to cannibalize it. I just want Elizabeth Warren to be the Senate Minority Leader and then President. I'm done now. What happened?
What happened was a combo putter. And by the way, you're doing the right thing. The only thing all of us can do right now is organize, deal with each other, reach out to people, make contact, form a giant resistance to this whole horrible debacle. Never sink to the level of the white supremacists. I hate the word alt-right, and I'm not going to call them alt-right. To the white supremacists who, with Pepe the Frog and their waving flags and their eagles and their crosses and all that jazz. You've done the right thing. I think that's the only thing we can do is hold one another and lift one another up in this. What happened was, in my opinion, an FBI, right-wing white people coup. The gerrymandering of the districts, the suppression of the voters, the lifting of the Voters' Rights Act, the crappy turnout, and the empowering of white people, the FBI absolutely tampering in this election, and the Russians hacking into this. They could see a vulnerability in our system. And, you know, I did a podcast in Europe, in London, in the summer, and it was the night before the Brexit vote, and no one in England thought Brexit was going to go through. And the next morning it went through, and it went through the same way this one did, with all the little rural areas and all the old white people pushing it through. And if you know anything, then you do. England's economy is tanking. Banks are leaving there. Their money dropped from being worth $1.60 for the pound to now it's about $1.20. So if you have money in England or an investment or you are an English person, your money is worth 30-40% less. And this is what happens when you let right-wing coups go on. And there's, you know, right-wing parties in every country in Europe, notably Holland, Scandinavia, and Greece, that we hear about, but they're everywhere. And I think it happened here. You know, this is when we were little, David, you remember the movie 7 Days in May with Burt Lancaster and Kirk Douglas?
Just watched it the other night on TCM.
Yeah,
by the way, you're on TCM.
Yes.
We'll get to that in a second.
All right. Anyway, that's what I think happened, David. And what's disappointing on top of everything else is there was no equivalency between the two candidates. Hillary Clinton, no matter what anyone thought of her, was amazingly qualified to be president. I think even her strangest critic would agree that her lifetime of being a lawyer, first lady, senator, cabinet member, positioned her rather well to have some insight into what is required to be president, against basically a real estate developer, kind of gangster type from New York, low-level celebrity huckster dude who, on top of being a racist and a misogynist and an avowed sexual predator, you saw his face the other day when he met with Obama. It was like... it was like if you asked me to go write a Nobel Prize winning position on particle physics and have it ready in the morning.
Mm-hmm. Well,
he looked, like every tin pot tyrant puppet dictator looks when they're finally given the keys. He looked like he was going to explode
out of fear or rage. Or both?
Both. I think right now he's feeling his way because he's never actually dealt with grown-up people. He deals with Rudy Giuliani and Bannon and Manafort and all those. Corey Lewandowski, those sub-rosy, screamy, white guy, entitled types. And now when you get into Washington, you're into entrenched establishment positions. Obama was calm and judicious and acted calm with him, and I think that kind of freaked him out. He claims they'd never met before, and Obama's, of course, been calling him out and saying he was unfit to be president, and now there they are in the room together in the palace in front of the bust of Martin Luther King, which wasn't lost on anyone, that irony. And a black president greeting a white supremacist candidate in a room with Martin Luther King's bust to hand over the keys of power was probably one of the worst moments of my life.
Mm-hmm. And you've seen me do stand-up.
Huh?
And you've
seen
me do stand-up.
Well, the thing is, I hate that, you know, that trope that, oh, it's great for comedy and all that. People used to say that when Bush was president. It was like, I would trade anything for a better world. I don't care if I can make some caustic remarks about the, you know, the bloviating yam with the bad hair,
right.
Blah, blah, blah.
It's great for heroin dealers, too.
Right. I was going to say, it's great for Oxy dealers. It's great for people who put up road signs because the rednecks are going to spend the next 4 years celebrating by shooting every road sign around the country. I have an avenue, and that makes it fun. I mean, I get to talk to you and other intelligent people, and I get to do my podcast and my stand-up. And fortunately for me, and I don't know whether it was by design or luck, I'm in Portland and Vancouver for my next two stops, and so there will be some modicum of sanity. I think if I was going to Lexington, Kentucky, and, you know, Tennessee, I might lose my shit.
Yeah, but, you know, if you look at the those states, they have a good number of blue people there. And by
absolutely.
That, I mean oxygen deprived. No, they have a lot of Democrats. So before we here's the way my show is going to be going for the next year until Trump is removed from office legally. We're going to complain. We're going to make jokes, but we're also going to give marching orders. What are the marching orders, Greg Proops?
First of all, anyone you know that hasn't had a major operation or needs some kind of medical care, they've got to do it right away before January 20th because he is going to gut the healthcare system. Secondly, if you are friends with minority groups like women, Jews, Muslims, anyone who's Hispanic, Latin, Asian, whatever, it's time to bolster each other. The first thing I would do is join the ACLU and give them money because Anthony Romero's threatened an army of lawyers against them, and that's the best way to contest these.
Excuse me for one second. Alex, get me the number of the ACLU, please. No, seriously, we've been doing this all. Get the address for the ACLU. It's ACLU, I think, .org, but let's double check. I agree with you, and I do give to the ACLU and the Southern Poverty Law Center. You got to give.
I was going to say the Southern, what's it called, Jennifer, the law?
Southern Poverty Law Center. They won't leave you alone.
Southern Poverty. There are two, because they do, I realize that's reaching a bit national, but the thing is they do great work, and they have the legal means to start things.
They're in Mississippi or Alabama. I mean, they're headquartered in the belly of the beast. And my mother.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, my mother calls me. She says, I got to stop giving money to the Southern Poverty Law Center. They won't leave me alone. They keep calling for money. And I go, you know, that's who I give money to, the people who won't leave me alone.
They're located in Montgomery, Alabama. And okay. Their webpage right now says, President Trump, white supremacists think their man won the White House.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a lot of information on the Southern Poverty Law Center site because, mind you, this is run by lawyers. This isn't crazy people with egg avatars.
What do you say
to the Trump transition team? It has a pledge to they're sending a petition to Trump to make sure that he honors to being president for all Americans. There's a thing. Emily Gordon, who's married to Kamal, friend is a writer and producer who does the Meltdown show on Comedy Central, has a list on her Tumblr of lots of places to go. The CAIR is the Council on American Islamic Relations. They have a website. It's at CAIR.com.
Okay. Hang on. Let's not, I'm Jewish. Let's not push it too far. No, I'm kidding.
I didn't say you had to eat with them, David.
I'm joking.
You know, Muslims are Semites too.
I know.
We're all Semites in the same big Semite family. if you go on Emily Gordon's Tumblr, which is emilyvgordon.tumblr.com, she has a fantastic list of all these things. The Muslim Advocates, Black Youth Project, Showing Up for Racial Justice, ACLU, of course, is listed.
Okay, so we'll get back to that in a second.
Sure. And the other thing I would do is Planned Parenthood. And
Planned Parenthood, Planned Parenthood, Planned Parenthood, Planned Parenthood, Planned Parenthood, Planned Parenthood, Planned Parenthood. Give money to Planned Parenthood. I am so stupid that I had to go see Jane Edith Wilson's movie, Janine from Iowa. Have you ever seen that?
I haven't, but I know Jane Edith, and she's fantastic.
Yeah, I'll send you the link to her movie. It's amazing, but now is not the time for comedy. But I didn't know, this is how dumb I am, I didn't know that, I'm ashamed to say this, but until I saw this movie, I didn't know that women use Planned Parenthood for mammograms and health. That it was, that I just thought they went in there for, you know, for their whatevers.
Oh, no. It's a whole healthcare situation.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So, how is the middle class doing in London since Brexit? You know, when you have a populist uprising, the people are supposed to benefit from the Huey Longs. How are they faring in countries where there's been a populist uprising? Like,
I don't think they're doing that well. I mean, I think that they're scared to death because when the first thing that happened was all the foreign countries that, London was the financial capital of Europe, and Frankfurt's the other financial capital of Europe. And all the banks started pulling and making plans to pull, and all the foreign countries that invest in research and development and tech industries and other industries started to pull the minute Brexit happened because of the giant legal morass of entanglement and bullshit that leaving the EU requires. And so I hear anecdotal things about people bumming out because now they have to move to Germany, and they didn't want to live in Germany. They wanted to live in London because London is a pretty swinging, you know, like New York, it's happening. There's been a very depressed, I think, feeling in England over what they feel kind of powerless to stop. Now, you may have noticed lately in the last few weeks, the EU's kind of trying to let them off the hook. They haven't invoked – I'm not going into the technical details because it's so inconceivably tedious. But Article 50 is the legal species that they have to invoke in order to leave the EU, and the EU's giving them time to not do it, and, you know – basically, I think they're trying to kind of weasel out of it, which they should be trying to do. The only good upshot, I think, to the Brexit in England was that Theresa May is not a terrible prime minister. David Cameron was an awful human and a terrible prime minister. He is basically responsible for floating the entire Brexit. It didn't have to be voted on. He wanted to get it over with, right?
He didn't even want it.
Yeah, he thought it would just whip through. He could stand his ground. And you notice that he dumped and cut and run the minute it happened. And then Nigel Farage and all the other right-wing supremacist leaders in England did the same. They all cut and ran. The upside of it, as I say, is they have a female PM, and she's conservative but not a psychopath. Also, there's a female PM in Scotland. Their first minister is a woman as well, so there's some good. And I think they're having to reconsider their own racism, and like we are. Now, we haven't reconsidered it yet because we've spent this week with the internet being full of vicious right-wing trolls crowing over their victory. But I think in a couple of weeks, when everything calms down, we'll get to reconsider that. And then, of course, I think the media has a fair share of blame as well as the FBI.
The FBI and, to, I hate to be a cliche, and manufacturing consent. They've already, I can see CNN falling in line. Television is so incendiary, if and radio is so incendiary. You know, Rwanda, that Holocaust in Rwanda could not have happened had there not been radio, had they not given instructions, had the Hutus not given instructions to the Tutsis to start slicing heads off. It was radio. I mean, it's a very radio first. Radio is very powerful because you get in that head. Television is the second most powerful thing. And in America, it's all about consent and calming the people down. I'm all for calming people down because I believe in no drama Obama. I don't think people should be angry. I think people should be angry, but it should be a calm, simmering rage and being methodical and remembering that Hillary won.
Yeah, she did.
And she would have won the Electoral College if people were allowed to vote. Let me ask you about my liberal friends who say, let's first give Donald Trump the benefit of the doubt. Suppose he just told 60 Minutes that he's going to keep the parts of Obamacare that work. If he comes up with an infrastructure plan to build roads like Hitler did, the Autobahn, shouldn't we give Hitler the benefit of the doubt? I mean, the Autobahn, you know, Volkswagen, he's putting people back to, shouldn't we give Donald Trump the benefit of the doubt because he's our president?
Well, in one way, I think we have no choice. If this goes through...
Wrong. The smartest man in the world is wrong. Go ahead.
Well, no, we shouldn't. This
right.
is analogous to Weimar Germany. You have to cut the dragon's head off before it gets any bigger.
Exactly.
I think he has to be resisted in every single way. It's unacceptable that a misogynist, sexual predator, racist should be president. It's absolutely unacceptable.
Exactly.
When W. performed his little mini coup in 2000 and 2004, and him and Karl Rove engineered those two elections, I had a joke, and I'm going to bring it back, which is, I'm surprised Haiti didn't invade us to install a democracy.
Great.
Because the jiggering, pokering, and the gerrymandering were extraordinary, and that's how W. got in. The difference is, W. was obviously a front for a consortium of
yes.
petrochemical and gigantic
yes.
defense contracting type
yes.
corporate people who wanted to open up Central Asia and destabilize it for our profit. This seems even less... I can understand their crap greedy motives because it was about money. And if you recall, W. always threatened to abortion and Social Security and all that and never did a thing about it. He didn't care at the end of the day. And I think what we've got here is a real right-wing, like you say, backlash uprising here, which makes it more odious. It flies in the face of what's going on in the country, which is that we're probably more diverse and successful than
mm-hmm.
we ever were.
Mm-hmm.
So that denial of reality is a real dangerous thing. We can't live in a fact-free world. We have to live in a world where we're involved with other countries and other people, and we start to understand that if there's anything good about America, it's that we had, Rosa Parks and Willie Mays. That's what makes America great.
It's the inelegant way he won. He just won so dirty. At least there was something, at least George W. Bush and President Reagan put up, for lack of a better word, a pretty face to the ugliness.
Well, they were both fronts for... Reagan and his group of criminals that came in and pilfered, as you well remember, in the
right.
80s. 350 people indicted in his administration for snatching and grabbing, including the head of the EPA, including the head of the Housing and Urban Development, everyone who went down in Contragate, the head of the CIA, who they basically, took his brain out during the middle of the hearings.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, W's administration, where everybody thought it would never fail, and then Rumsfeld had to resign, Rove had to resign, they all... You know, the birds come home to roost legally at a certain point. And the legal genius of Freddie Gonzalez couldn't save them. But the ramifications are much more dire. You're giving this short-fingered Bulgarian bloviating yam access to the Supreme Court, and his nominations will go through if he doesn't have 4 years of infighting with every Republican, because he hates everyone. Now, my friend Greg Gutfeld is a Fox News reporter, and he does a show called The Greg Gutfeld Show, mm-hmm. and he also does The Five, and he used to do Red Eye. And he's from San Mateo, and we're buddies, and we have been for a long time. And he's conservative, but he hates Trump, and he's been against him. And he keeps telling me that the silver lining is that Trump craves acceptance and love so much that he's not going to change everything. And that his take on him is that he's not even really a Republican or a right-winger. He's basically an atheist, creepy businessman who just wanted this opportunity to get in there.
What is Nazi? You're the smartest man in the world. What does Nazi stand for?
What'd you say?
You're the smartest man. You really are. What does Nazi mean? What is it?
Nazi?
Yeah, what does it mean?
What does Nazi mean?
What does it stand for?
Well, I think...
the initials.
His campaign...
No, the initials
so
Nazi. National...
A clarion call.
Greg, I'm going to ask
white
you...
White people who feel hard done by.
Can you hear me?
I'm very sick of the economic anxiety.
Are you there?
Do it. You may remember during the 30s in Germany, that was the same narrative. Oh, my God, Europe fucked us over. We had to pay reparations. Germany's not what it was because, you know, the outside influences and the Hebrews and all that and their banking. And it was really not very thinly veiled, especially Trump's last few messages about the international banking conspiracy and all that.
Right.
On top of is any Muslim, any Mexican, any black, any women, any gay. That's what a Nazi is. I think.
Right. But what is, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. The national, what does it stand for? What are the initials for?
I think it was the National Socialist Party.
Right. And so this is when your friend Greg Gutfeld and I have other liberal friends who are saying, well, you know, he's a Democrat. He's not really a Republican. What Hitler did was, and I'm going to, you know, I'm bringing up Hitler, like you said.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
there's no other.
No, yeah. Hitler, the National Socialist, he was all over the map. In other words, he appropriated every ideology to be become chancellor. And by the way, he didn't win the popular vote either, Hitler.
No, he didn't. And the step in it, and then the crystal knocked. But that's what I'm afraid of. We've had the putsch, and now what I'm afraid of is the crystal knocked, you know, where there's a big sweep, and then, oh, gee whiz, you happen to be Jewish, or you happen to be Muslim, or you happen to disagree with him. Right-wing trolls are already trolling people to get liberals to kill themselves. Every woman I know that's a comedian has had their, you know, Twitter site jumped on. Every woman I know that's a journalist has endured insane threats and nonsense. It's very serious, and I agree with you. I think that's what Hitler did was he, first of all, lacking any ideology of his own, he, you know, cobbled together a bunch of shit ideology. Calling them socialists, right, is a genius move, but that's like calling the Republicans alt-right instead of what it is, which is white supremacist. Here's what Gutfeld said to me. He's faking pro-life to get evangelicals. He's an atheist. He will back away from every single thing.
But look who he's surrounding himself. Ebel, the world's most renowned climate change denier, is going to head the EPA. I mean, it's, as you said earlier, it's who he surrounds himself with.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, look at the cabinet he's proposing is absolutely a circus car, a clown car full of to let Rudy Giuliani near the Justice Department is pure folly. I heard the Sarah Palin thing. I don't know if that's true, that he's floating her. If you're
see if she's a witch or not.
Climate change or anything like that. Every one of the... To me, this reminds me of a combo platter of, like, the Harding administration and the Reagan administration, because they let everyone in to feed at the trough. And mm-hmm. I get the feeling that that's the first and foremost goal of a Trump administration is to make sure everyone gets rich.
Two questions before we go, and then we'll plug your gigs. And thank you for doing this. And
of course,
we need.
I wish I could have been funnier.
Hang on. I'll talk to you about how about political satire in another show. It's enough.
Okay.
It's enough with the getting your news from comedians, and you know, this is. If you're going to get your news from comedians, comedians got to give news. And so being funny, this is funny is a narcotic. It's an opiate. It makes you feel good. Now is not the time to feel good.
I think you're right, David. Jen Kirkman said it the other day. She's worried about comedy being a distraction because we're distracted enough and we need to focus.
Yeah. Yeah. With this comedy boom. And this is what I'm going to keep repeating this on the show over and over again. The ACLU, their phone number is 212-549-2500. Call the ACLU and donate money. Planned Parenthood's toll-free number to donate money is 1-800-798-70. I can't read your writing, Alex. Is it 7092? Yes, it's 7092. 1-800-798-7092. Give money to Planned Parenthood. They are certified by Greg Proops. Planned Parenthood, right? You certify Planned Parenthood?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I've been doing benefits for them and working with them off and on since Jennifer and I's first date was a Planned Parenthood. Because I know how to treat the ladies.
You're gonna get that abortion, honey, or we're not going to dinner. But so it's Planned Parenthood is certified by Greg Proops, the smartest man in the world. The ACLU is certified by Greg Proops, the smartest man in the world. If you're a Jew, Ivanka is an Orthodox Jew.
Mm-hmm.
And the joke I do in my act is that she makes love through the same hole in the sheet, through a hole in the sheet that her dad wears at his rallies. It's a nice joke. I didn't tell it right. People go, well, he's married, his daughter converted. We're safe.
Mm-hmm.
Tell the Jews why they're not safe.
Well, as you know, Hitler's favorite in his cabinet, his architect of the whole thing was Albert Speer.
Was he Jewish?
More than willing to rat out all of the Jews.
Was he Jewish?
No, I think he was half Jewish. No one ever talked about it because he was such a great architect that they really wanted him in there.
Hmm.
No one's safe. It's an old, maxim from World War II, but it's absolutely true. First they came for the trade unionists, but I didn't say anything. Then they came for the Jews, and I didn't say anything because I wasn't Jewish. And then they came for me, and there was no one to speak up. And that's why you're not safe. He's anti-Semitic, and he's openly anti-Semitic. The fact that his son-in-law and his daughter is nominally Jewish, or is Jewish, but his son-in-law is Jewish. There's plenty of Jews complicit in violence against Jews.
Mm-hmm.
Let's be honest about that.
Mm-hmm.
Just like there's plenty of, everyone has to speak up for everyone else right now. And that means setting aside your own prejudices.
What do you say? Let me ask you a question, because I know you've been very generous with your time, and I know if I keep it short, you'll come back. So what do you say to somebody who has, what do you say to Latinos, Hispanics, women, who, Arabs, Muslims, who are frightened? People say they shouldn't be frightened. If somebody is seen punching a woman, should other women be frightened? Do they have a right? Do people have a right to be frightened?
Absolutely. And the only way to assuage fear is knowledge. You have to learn. You have to educate yourself, teach yourself, and surround yourself with people you can trust. Everyone has a right to be frightened right now. Women are facing a guy who's an open sexual predator, who disrespects women entirely, who's the president. And it was okay with the electorate that happened. And that's not a good thing. So, yes, people have the right to be frightened, and women in particular. And this is even more insidious, David. when you think about all the white men and white women that voted for him, I feel like I'm in Invasion of the Body Snatchers with Donald Sutherland, and that every other person I look at, I'm thinking, they voted for Trump, didn't they?
Mm-hmm.
And even less pertinent but still horrible is, what about the people who didn't vote at all and thought that they could slide through this one because they don't like either candidate, no politics is rigged, and all that bullshit nonsense that people who obviate themselves from any adult responsibility always fall back on?
Right. Okay.
There's a zillion people who didn't vote at all just because they're like, well, I don't like Hillary,
yeah,
or whatever stupid-ass reason they had. And
yeah,
they're as complicit. The people who don't speak up are as guilty as the people who spoke up and threw a Mazel Tov cocktail.
Mm-hmm. We're going to wrap it up. Greg Proops, are you part of the 1%?
Oh, absolutely. I'm part of the 1% of awesome.
Yeah, you're the smartest man in the world, but are you part of the 1%?
Probably. I don't know.
No, you're not.
I think for it's diabolical.
No, I'm making a point.
I'm
making a point.
How funny
I am. Do you have to work for a living? Do you have to work for a living?
No, I do comedy.
But I'm saying is you need people to support you. So where are you?
Oh, yeah.
Where are you? Where, let's plug some gigs.
Thanks, David.
Yes.
First of all, I do the Smartest Man in the World podcast that drops every Monday. It's free on iTunes or gregproops.com.
So slow down.
I do the Smartest Man in the World podcast. You can get it for free on iTunes every Monday morning.
Mm-hmm.
This Monday's episode was recorded before the election where I thought Hillary was going to win.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll be a little window into what our optimism felt like a week ago.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next podcast I'm doing, I will be in Portland at the Helium Comedy Club this Thursday through Sunday, and Sunday I'll be doing the podcast there, and that's the podcast where I'm going to do what you're doing. The first half is going to be assigning blame to everyone that I hate. The second half is going to be a clarion call to arms where I give out nothing but information. And like you, my crusade, because I have a platform, however small it is to educate and inform people about what they can do to make this better.
And
in the face of this hideousness.
And how do you remain? So if people want to help you remain financially solvent, they can buy your CDs on Amazon.
What absolutely.
Let's just plug away. GregProops.com.
I have an album called In the Ballpark, where we talk a lot about women. The podcast, of course, if you support it, you're helping my advertisers, Poetry Foundation, and all the other pieces. I'll be in New York City. If you want to come and see me there, at the Bell House in Brooklyn on Friday, November 25th, the day after Thanksgiving. So after you're done hating on your relatives, you can come and blow out steam with me. And yes, we'll still be on the same topic then.
Good.
And then I'll be going to London and Paris, in Vancouver, then London and Paris to do the podcast. Jennifer hooked me up with Shakespeare Company Bookstore in Paris. And I did a book reading last year of my book, which if you wish to buy is called The Smartest Book in the World. You can go on my website and buy that. And we're going to do a podcast from Shakespeare and Company upstairs with the historian of Shakespeare and Company. So it won't be so political as much as a history of that fantastic bookstore, which is an English language bookstore in Paris, started by beatniks in the old days.
Great. Last question.
We're going to try to keep the world aloft with poetry and activism.
Yes. I love you, Greg Proops. Here's my final question. We started together in San Francisco and Reagan was president.
1954.
You and I have lived through Reagan. We've lived through George W. Bush. Are we going to let this happen again?
No, I don't think we can. We're getting a little advanced in comedic years to keep going through this charade. I was really shocked by this one and revolted that another internal coup happened on our watch. And I agree with you, man. I mean, we watched the Reagan coup. We watched the W coup. It's just...
I'm
hoping they would run out of steam, but they're not.
No, they get worse. They get worse.
And so I think this is the... I said to Jennifer today, you know, this whole I want to move away to Canada or whatever, it's a very white people privileged thing to say that. The best thing to do is stand and fight.
I'm gonna say something, and then you get the last word. There were medical experiments conducted on gypsies, homosexuals, Catholics, and Jews in concentration camps. And the American Medical Association has sealed those experiments. They say they are unacceptable. We're not interested in the studies that Joseph Mengele conducted in concentration camps. If Donald Trump, in his inaugural, announces a moonshot plan to cure cancer, tell him to shove it up his ass. You get you get the last word.
I agree with you, David. I wouldn't trust this guy as far as I wouldn't trust any real estate developer. They're more evil than armed dealers.
I love you. I can't wait to talk to you again. Give my love to Jennifer. You're a great.
I will. Come and see us in New York, or maybe we can have a cup of coffee or something.
I would love that. It is an honor.
I love you too, baby.
It's an honor to know you. Greg Proops.
Thanks, David.
Thank
I love you.
I love you.
Bye. Cheers.
So this is how you call Chuck Schumer's office. It's very easy. You go to www.schumer.senate.gov. This is perfectly legal, by the way. This is not a crank call. And you call your senator. Now, it's not working. Hang on, because the service in the studio is, I'm online. Hang on. Stay with me, folks. This is very important. Chuck Schumer, U.S. Senator Chuck Schumer, all right, it's not coming up because the internet is slow here. But we're going to do this in real time to show you how easy it is. Chuck Schumer, you Google his name, S-C-H-U-M-E-R. A little slow. Well, we should be able to get, I can't get internet. All right, so.
Let me try, what is it?
I don't have the number. Go look it up. Maybe you have internet service in your in the back. Here we go. It's finally came up. Leave a comment. Help for New Yorkers. Let's find his phone number here. Help for New York. At the end. About newsroom. Here, contact. God damn it. Contact. Well, he's only taking emails. He doesn't want you to call him. But his number is listed, so phone number.
I got it.
212-486-4430. We're going to call and leave a message with Chuck Schumer. This is his office number, 212-486-4430, Senator Charles E. Schumer. And I'm going to politely tell him he's not up for the job. And he should step aside for Elizabeth Warren. So are you dialing the number? 212-486-4430. You know, you can march. That's also good. Marching is good. I can't hear. Oh, here we go. This is how you do it. This is how you act as a citizen. 212-486-4430. I'm calling Chuck Schumer's office. I'll get an answering machine. And believe me, they pick up these messages and listen to them, and they get scared by them. They also get scared by letters. Not emails are, anybody can write an email or sign an online petition. All right, they're not answering. Well, let's see. Chuck Schumer, Albany, Melville, Rochester, New York City, Syracuse, Buffalo. All these numbers, he's not answering. Ah, Washington, D.C. Okay, let's keep. All right, so I'll give you his address. Hang up. This is why Elizabeth Warren has to be Washington, D.C. Call 202 224-6542.
You have reached the Washington office of U.S. Senator Chuck Schumer. Our office is now closed. We kindly ask that you call back during our normal business hours, which are Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. Thank you and have a great evening.
Thanks for calling. Goodbye.
Really? Really? Okay. Let's call Elizabeth Warren's office. Chuck Schumer is just... No, we're going to run this in real time because I want to show how easy it is to contact your senator or a politician. Because I've shown you how easy it is to get in touch with Chuck Schumer. Amazing. WarrenSenator.gov. Okay. How do you contact her? Contact. Email. No, I want to call her.
I got it.
Huh?
I got it.
You got her number?
Mm-hmm.
What is it?
202-224-4543.
Write it down so I can give it out.
Thank you for calling the office of Senator Elizabeth Warren. Sorry no one is available to take your call. Please leave a message with your name, phone number, and address or email address. Have a great day.
Hello, I'm leaving a message for Senator Elizabeth Warren. My name is David Feldman. I'm a Democrat. I would like her to run for president, please, and I'd like her to challenge Senator Schumer. He's not up for the job as minority leader in the Senate. Elizabeth Warren is, and I strongly encourage Elizabeth Warren to try to steal the post of Senate Minority Leader from Chuck Schumer. Once again, my name is David Feldman. Please run for president. Thank you. That's how it's done. So that's Elizabeth Warren's phone number. She answers her phone, 202-224-4543. Chuck Schumer, New York City, tool of Wall Street. The reason he's going to be the Senate Minority Leader is because, like Rahm Emanuel, when he was a congressman, was tapped into Goldman Sachs and Wall Street. So you want more of the same in the Democratic Party. You want the Clinton wing to continue to strangle the progressive movement, which they have. Encourage Chuck Schumer to become the Senate Minority Leader. He won't even answer his phone. Senator Elizabeth Warren, who should be president, needs to be in the Senate blocking everything. That's how you can be an active citizen. You leave messages on the machines of responsive legislators. Chuck Schumer will not even take a message. So we have to send a message. You have to call Senator Warren at 202-224-4543, ask her to run for president, give your name, be respectful, and give me Senator Chuck Schumer's address. I think I have it. We're going to write to Senator Chuck Schumer. Okay, let's see. Maybe This is what we're going to do. Do we have his phone, his address?
Chuck Schumer?
Yeah, what's his address? And this is why the Republicans win, because they do primary challenges and they scare the crap out of moderates. So you want moderates? You got your Hillary and you got your Chuck Schumer, and they're worthless. They moderates, just not an original idea. They just want to win and then go get rich. What's Chuck Schumer's address? So this is the way it's going to be for the next 2 years before Trump is impeached. So we're going to still be funny, but we're going to talk about marching orders and obstructionism. Protesting is great. It's dangerous, but you need to protest. I'm afraid to protest. Here. That's Chuck Schumer's?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's his mailing address.
So we're going to write letters to Chuck Schumer. 322 Hart Senate Office Building, Washington, D.C., 20510. That's Senator Chuck Schumer, Amy's cousin. Is it S-C-H-U-M-E-R? Send a postcard, write a letter to Senator Charles Schumer, 322 Hart Senate Office Building, Washington, D.C., 20510. If you're from New York or from any state in the union, you can write to him. He's my senator, but if he's going to be the Senate minority leader, he's everybody's senator. Write to him. Don't be polite, but don't curse. Say something along the lines of, we respectfully ask you to step aside and allow Elizabeth Warren to become the Senate Minority Leader, because you're not up to the job. That's it. He's not up to the job of stopping the wheels of government in Washington, D.C., blocking everything that the Republicans want, the same way they pretty much did with Obama. He's not up to the job. So write to Senator Charles Schumer at 322 Hart, H-A-R-T, Senate Office Building, Washington, D.C., 20510.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.